Ok, es aquí. Un aplauso para Lauren Stolper, que está aquí con nosotros. Of course, welcome, Lawrence. We're very happy to have you here in Mexico. Y les pido un aplauso, ustedes son quienes también, Alfonso André, baterista de Los Caifanes. Y también les pido un aplauso para una persona que ha sido clave también para entender, descifrar y compartir el rock, que es Enrique Blanc. ¡Aplausos, Enrique! Como siempre, gracias a la Feria del Libro de Guadalajara por recibirnos. En esta ocasión recibimos a estos grandes personajes y sobre todo quiero hacer especial énfasis en lo que significa para nosotros tener a Lawrence en esta feria. Yo te lo dije, Lawrence, cuando hicimos la presentación en Querétaro en el festival, y lo creo, la escena de la música, específicamente del rock, pero de la música nacional, de la escena del rock mexicano, no hubiera sido lo que fue y lo que sigue siendo si no hubiera sido por The Cure. Por eso, gracias. En ese sentido, creo que estamos con dos presentadores, Alfonso y Enrique, que tienen mucho que ver con eso, como cómo recibieron esta escena cuando aquí tenemos muy poco, y cómo Alfonso la asumió y la banda, que es Caifanes, claramente, y quiero decirlo muy claro, no replicó, sino como que asumió algunos sonidos, algunos looks, y después de eso hizo algo nuevo. Y eso es lo que representa para nosotros Caifanes, que sin Caifanes nuestra escena nacional no hubiera sido la que es. Yo quiero decir brevemente, el libro que hace Lord Dolphers tiene que ver con, primero, su infancia en Crawley, que es un pueblo en Inglaterra que no tenía una escena importante en la que dijeras, bueno, aquí vienen todos los músicos. No era Londres, no era París, no era Guadalajara, era un lugar ahí como inhóspito, en donde este hombre y otro que supongo que conoce, que se llama Robert Smith, dijeron, vamos a hacer esto. Y vamos a ser a veces ridículos, a veces vamos a ser contestatarios, a veces vamos a ser inentendidos, pero vamos a hacer esta escena, no, vamos a hacer este grupo. Y después hicieron todo en la escena. También es importante decir que es muy importante que el libro que escribe LOL es un libro muy valiente, porque no todo el mundo se atreve a decir, yo tuve esto, 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 esto y esto, y después tuve un problema de adicción. Y tuve que luchar con eso día, 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 y al final me quedé de ese asunto. Sobre todo cuando en el mundo del rock, pues lo que se supone que debes hacer es, perdón por mi lexicon, ponerte pedo, drogarte, despertar al día siguiente sin saber dónde estás, y that's rock and roll, ¿no? Pero en este caso, Lowell tuvo como este momento de decir, no se trata de esto, en mi caso, voy a hacer algo al respecto y me voy a curar. Es un libro que habla no del anecdotario, sino de la literatura, desde la literatura, y me parece que es importante para el rock, para los vacíos que tenemos todos, ¿no? Y el valor que necesitamos para, digamos, describir los dolores que nos pasan. Y para terminar, todos pensamos, cuando nosotros en la vida del rockstar, es todo chingón, traigo un coche increíble, chavas, chupe y pachanga, ¿no? Y sí, puede ser eso, pero hay un momento que puede decir no y seguir adelante como lo hizo LOL. Entonces yo agradezco que estén todos ustedes aquí, agradezco que esté LOL porque es un lujo que tengamos aquí en la Feria del Libro de Guadalajara a LOL. Y me gustaría darle la palabra a Enrique para que nos platicara de su perspectiva de este libro y también de lo que ha impactado en nuestro país. Te quiero.
Hola, ¿qué tal? Muy buenas noches. Pues en principio creo que me dio mucho gusto subirme entre las páginas de Cure, este libro autobiográfico de Lord Tolkien. En principio porque creo que en tiempos muy recientes, y es algo que me genera mucho entusiasmo, muchos músicos, particularmente músicos de rock, han mirado un poco hacia el periodismo, hacia la literatura, a través del recuento de sus propias memorias, de su historia personal de vida. Creo que eso nos brinda muchísimo conocimiento y nos permite entender no solamente al músico, como él mismo lo puntualiza en algún momento del libro, sino a la persona, entender como la dimensión humana, quién está detrás, pese a todo eso que se habla, que tiene que ver con el rock, la conexión con el glamour, el superestrellato, la fama, el dinero, etcétera, los viajes, en fin. Recientemente, bueno, Bruce Springsteen, Neil Young, Pete Townshend, Bob Dylan, todos ellos han estado también acercándose un poco a la literatura, al periodismo, a ese libro que tal tiene que ver con las memorias. Más adelante yo le preguntaré a Noel si ha leído algunos de estos libros y si alguno de ellos influyó en la decisión de contar su propia historia. Y creo que eso es lo que en gran medida aporta también este libro. Hay un momento en él, voy a remitirme a lo que hablaba Mariana, en donde Lord Tolbert y Robert Smith se reconcilian en un club en Los Ángeles, California, en The Palace. Yo también, como Lord Tolbert, viví 8 años en Los Ángeles, California, y me tocó presenciar el primer concierto de Soda Stereo en ese sitio. Y Soda Stereo es otra banda que me dio mucho por The Cure, una banda argentina. Es decir, el impacto de The Cure no solamente fue un impacto en México, claro. Hace ratito, Alfonso Andrejo le mostraba la portada del primer álbum de Caifanes y Lord dijo, ¿dónde estoy? pero creo que eso se repartió aún más allá. Es decir, la influencia de The Cure no solamente se remite a México, sino se remite a toda América Latina. Bueno, obviamente la parte de nuestra zona que la tenemos como muy conocida. Y hay una cosa también como muy importante, que es que en el libro el propio Lord narra la primera presentación que The Cure tuvo en Argentina. No se las cuento, es muy emocionante y vale mucho la pena verla.
No, y no contaste la tocada que tuvieron en una institución para enfermos mentales. ¿Te acuerdas de esa?
Está esa, y hay una que me gusta muchísimo, que es la narración de ese concierto en Atenas, en un festival donde estaban The Clash, The Pitch Mode, Total Club y The Cure. Y tuvieron que, bueno, era un momento complicado políticamente en Grecia, y bueno, tuvieron que salir corriendo. Creo que ese es el mayor susto que Lord ha tenido en su vida como músico.
Yeah, there was a lot of stuff going on. It was kind of crazy, but you know, it was funny that I was talking to Boy George, and he was there as well. And I talked to him about a month ago, and he remembered it as being really crazy too.
Antes de darle la palabra a Alfonso Andrés, nada más, en estas historias que uno piensa en The Cure y en todos estos discos que nos formaron, que escuchamos cuando éramos chavitos, que seguimos escuchando, pero hay un episodio que a mí me gusta muchísimo, I'm sorry, I'm gonna be protected, es cuando estaban súper chavitos ellos, y estaban Robert, Mike y you, y entonces tuvieron una tocada en un X lugar, y estaban tan pedos que ya no pudieron manejar más, entonces llegaron a un lugar que era como un hospital psiquiátrico. Entonces dijeron, ya, nos vamos a dormir, mañana ya vemos qué hacemos. Ya se quedaron ahí, pues allá en la mitad del pastizal, pues. Y a veces se despertaron. Y así de, ¿qué pasó? Todos peludísimos. Y había los enfermos que estaban alrededor. Y como había plantíos de coles y calabazas, entonces los enfermos empezaron así a ver los lados y empezaron así a ver coles, calabazas. Y entonces dijimos, vamos a los chicos, porque nos van a matar con los locos a calabazazos.
Yeah, we were going to make cabbage to death.
Alfonso André, ¿qué significa para ti The Cure y Lawrence Conference? Siendo tú un baterista, fundador.
No me pressure, because I'm sitting right next to you. No, pues que les puedo contar. The Cure fue importantísimo en mi formación como músico. Yo crecí escuchando otro tipo de rock. Empezado en los 70s, rock después progresivo, mucho King Crimson, jazz y toda esta música súper compleja. Y yo me sentía muy complicado, porque yo era un músico de estos de academia que toca 800 minutos por segundo. Y todo este movimiento que vino de Inglaterra, todo el movimiento dark y también el punk por otro lado, como que nos daba chance a chavos que queríamos tocar, pero no teníamos tampoco la técnica o las experiencias o la academia para hacerlo a la manera del rock progresivo, nos daba chance de hacer música, de expresarnos, subirnos a un escenario y hacer lo que podíamos hacer con las herramientas que teníamos. El chiste era el mensaje, no tener algo que decir. Entonces, para nosotros fue importantísimo descubrir bandas como The Cure, como Six and the Banshees, Bauhaus, todas estas bandas que empezaban a sonar a principios de los 80s. Y más que tratar de hacer una versión mexicana de The Cure, pues tomábamos elementos como el look de los panamados, por ejemplo, Saúl dice que es de la película de Tintán, del Chava Nicola. Pero creo que tiene más bien de bandas como Fiuxi, The Banshees, y The Cure, obviamente, y Alba. Pero más que tomar el sonido, ¿sí? O la música que estaban haciendo, era tratar de tomar elementos de todo esto que nos estaba pasando en ese momento, que estábamos descubriendo, con todo el más bagaje que traíamos atrás, con todo lo que habíamos escuchado desde niños, ¿no? Vivir en México, escuchar música de todos lados. Habíamos desde los boleros que escuchaban nuestros padres, la música brasileña, la música, obviamente, de Estados Unidos, de Inglaterra. Y todo esto se combina, ¿no? Dentro de la cabeza y del alma de cada músico que participa en una banda y sale de distintas maneras. Y bueno, creo que Caifanes, pues, al tener muchísima influencia de estas bandas, pues, tiene también un sonido más propio, ¿no? Como decía María de Montserrat. La verdad es que es una maravilla poder como descubrir toda esta serie de eventos que pasaron durante la formación de The Cure, cómo tocaban en esos pequeños clubs o lugares improvisados muchas veces, lo mismo que nos pasó a nosotros, ¿no? Como que hay muchos puntos en común. De repente, leyendo este libro, encontraba muchos puntos en común, o sea, que estábamos del otro lado del mundo y en condiciones pues, muy diferentes. Las economías, ¿no? De México y de Inglaterra no tienen nada que ver, pero las bandas que empiezan, pues, parece que pasan por las mismas experiencias en cualquier parte del mundo. Entonces, eso fue muy interesante. Y el poder estar aquí al lado de Dolly es para mí un grandísimo honor. Mucho de que yo sea músico que esté tocando en este momento, se lo debo yo a ellos que lo dicen en este momento. I think really, you know, it's true what you said. We'll have to go through the same seven gates of hell to make music, you know, somewhere along the way. I spent the last 2 months going around in the south, in Peru, Chile. I was here before as well, in Argentina. And I understand that, you know, where music comes from and how it affects everybody, you know, and how if you grew up in the suburbs of South London, it's not that much different than the suburbs of Guadalajara or the suburbs of when it's theirs. You know, it's the same experience, and that's what we play, that experience.
Cuando hablábamos de justo de lugares de pronto inhóspitos o de pronto incluso la Ciudad de México que no tenía tantos lugares para tocar, pensamos, bueno, imagínate que empezaste a hacer música en Minatitlán. Momento, ¿sabe quién nació en Minatitlán? José Luis Quique de Café Tacuba. Entonces ellos y tomaron todos esos sonidos, hicieron un grupo como Café Tacuba. A lo que quiero ir es a que no importa dónde hayas nacido, si lo traes, lo puedes desarrollar independientemente de lo que sea la moda, lo que sea la costumbre, y puedes romper. Se piensa que el punk es romper con, no sé, guitarras, canciones cortas, con pocos acordes, pero el punk es también hacer una canción de rock con jaranas, como hicieron Café Tacuba. Y dicen, ¡es que es rock! Y no me importa, o vas tú, o sea, tú y yo, ¿qué quieres? Bueno, me gustaría hablar también con Loli de lo que significó para él hacer este libro y, digamos, los diferentes lugares en donde lo hizo, porque empezó en un lugar, luego estuvo en California, luego también hay un episodio en el desierto, y luego la trayectoria que tuvo este libro para llegar a su publicación y las respuestas que tiene. Son como muchos lugares, no solo físicos, sino emocionales.
Yeah, I mean, for me, I've thought about writing a book for a long time, and then a friend of mine called me from New York and said, are you still thinking of writing a book? I said, yeah. He said, well, I have a friend coming to Los Angeles, that's a publisher, you should see him. And then I had to pull up and go, yeah, okay, all right, I'm going to do it. But it still took me another 6 months after that, because I realized that I started doing a lot of research, reading a lot of different people's books. I really liked Patti Smith's book, Just Kids, you know. I also liked Duff McKagan's book, From Guns N' Roses, and I didn't know Duff, but I know him now, because we're like pen pals, we write to each other all the time, and his book was honest, you know, it's like, he tells the truth. And so I was scared for the first 6 months, because I thought, you know, the only way to do this is you have to be true. You have to tell the truth. If you don't tell the truth, people will read it and go, yeah, but, you know, he's not really telling you all of the story. And that seems to me that's like making a record or a music where you don't put everything that's you in it, you know? You might as well just play somebody else's songs. So, for the book, I really have to think, okay, am I prepared to be vulnerable, you know, completely open, because it's not just me, you know, it's my family, it's my son, all these people have to think about what they, and then in the end I think, well, yeah, but also it's my journey and I have to do it, so why not? And once I had started to do it, I felt it was the most wonderful creative journey that I have had since the cure. It was absolutely overwhelmed at times because it's a lot slower process. And it's been a slower process afterwards. You know, I've been talking about the book for 3 years now, all over the world. But it's very rewarding and yeah. I also wanted to do it before it got too old and couldn't remember. Yeah.
Yeah. Pero sí, eso es muy importante, este libro, que es muy honesto, ¿no? Se siente que te lo está diciendo con muchísima. El que está contando las historias con muchísima humildad y con muchísima verdad, ¿no? Realmente no está pintando lo bonito. Está haciendo las cosas que han pasado y eso es muy valiente.
Well, you know, it's only great that it comes from somebody who's on the same journey, you know. notes and yeah.
Obviamente el punto de partida es la historia de dos amigos que cumplen un sueño, digamos, ¿no? ¿Has tenido algún feedback por parte de Robert en relación a la lectura del libro o de algún otro miembro de la lectura que
oh, yeah.
te ha contado?
Oh yeah, oh yeah. Well, when I finished the book May 2016, and I met Robert and I gave him the first copy. I said, please read it. Anything, maybe you'll write forward if you've got time. If you haven't, don't worry. Some other people haven't. If there's anything in the book you don't like, tell me. Maybe I'll change it. I'm not sure. Maybe. And then I didn't hear anything. They went, Cure on tour. I didn't hear anything. And then one day, the book had been published in England and in the US. I got an email from Robert one night, and he said, "I'm really happy that you wrote a book. I think it's a really wonderful achievement. It's a really good thing to do. But," and I said, "Okay, well, what is the but? You know?" And he's got like 10 items. And I read through them, and he said, "No, so why did you say this?" And I read the items, and I realized none of them, not one item, was actually in the book. It was from reviews of the book that he'd read, and maybe the journalist had kind of changed things and not got it quite right. So I wrote back and said, "None of that stuff is in the book. This is what's in the book. This is what they say about it in the book." And then about a week later, I got an email and said, "Oh, okay, sorry, that's right." So, and I heard from Simon as well. And also, when I was writing the book, Michael Dempsey, we're sort of good friends. Yeah, Michael, Simon, Robert, Pearl, they're my teenage friends. So we're all sort of friends. You know, when we meet each other, we don't talk about music, or, we don't even talk about business, you know, we talk about family, we talk about people that we know, people that we've grown up with, people that have passed away, just like, other old guys when they get together, and take them and they go, "Oh, you remember so-and-so," that's what we do. And so, Michael came to see me, he stayed with me, with his family, for a month, and somebody had told me, "Oh, read Stephen King's book about writing because it's really good." And so I read it. And he said, "Don't put the book away when you finish it in the drawer. And then a month later, read it again and you'll take about 10% of it away. You know, you'll read 10%. And so I put it in the drawer and I said to Michael, "I finished the book. It's in that drawer over there. I'm not going to look at it, but it's in that drawer over there." And so in the month he was there, he took it out and he read it. And Michael is a very precise kind of person. You can hear that in his face. He's very precise. And he read it, and he just said to me, yeah, it's good. Okay. I'm like, okay. Big board because that means it's fine. You know? So yeah, that's what I heard about it from people.
And you are very generous with Robert, going back to that, because you say, and again, after that fight in that bar, Robert saved me again. That's a line that I really love because it tells a lot about your relationship. And I'm going to do this question again, or ask you to tell. After a lot of years, they asked you to play in Australia. It was your idea, and I'd like you to tell us about what was that about, and the dinner you had before that. It was just the other things that you...
So, it was the 30th anniversary of Faith, And I wrote to Robert and I said, you know, next year is the 30th anniversary of Faith. I've been playing some of the songs with my band, Levenhurst, we've been playing in Europe. I said to him, you know, it's been really fun and good to do them. I mean, I know, you know, fun, Faith, but it was fun. And so I said, why don't we go out and do that? And then I didn't hear anything from him, and I thought, oh, he's forgotten, he's forgotten. But about 4 months later, I had an email from him and he said, you know what, I've had a great idea, why don't we do the first 3 albums? And I went, oh, that's a good idea, because the trick with Robert is to make him think that he thought of the idea, you know, every time, right? I said, oh, that's a great idea you've had. And so we started to rehearse, and he said, okay, we should go to Australia to do the first shows with this. I said, well, why Australia? He said, well, I've never played the Opera House, and it's a beautiful place. He also said, we'll be far enough away from everybody else in case it all goes horribly wrong. You know? So, I don't know, internet, you know, about it instantaneously, but, you know, Robert doesn't have a, he doesn't have a lead, he doesn't have a, no, he has, he always says to me, do you have a smartphone? This is my Robert voice, by the way. Do you have a smartphone? Yes, I do. I don't. So, he has this little flip phone that he keeps in his pocket. Anyway, so we went to Australia and we did the shows. Before we did the shows, the night before we did the show, we thought we should have a big dinner with everybody just to get everybody in the mood. I mean, you know this, you know, you have to make, the band is like a gang. You know, you have to all be on the same side. So, from the line, well, yes, so I have heard, yes. And
you have to.
Yeah, it's about the chemistry. Joe Strummer said you can't mess with the chemistry of the band, and it's true. So we all got together, and I'm sitting here, Robert's sitting here, Simon is sitting here, and we're talking about things, and they start telling stories. No, do you remember when, you know, we did this in fact? No, I can't remember that. And you're like, yeah, you did that, you did this thing. It's like, in this band, all the stories in this band are about you. Okay, so there's another book, you know, right away, I just have to remember. Yeah, so. No! What are you doing? You pointed him, his stories about this.
I was wondering if he wanted to ask something, but that's true. You tell of these stories that they tell, and you think you weren't there, but you weren't, and they were like,
right. Yes, yeah. And then I have another story that goes along with that, that tells you about memory. Because when I started to write this book, I had no diaries, no journals, you know, I was an existentialist. You know, no photos, no, you know, the publisher said to me, we need 100 photos. I said, good luck. Yeah, about five, you know, that I have. So I had to, you know, kind of remember things. And memory is very slippery. You know, you think you remember everything perfectly, which is one reason why I said at the beginning of the book, this is my memoir. It's not so much an autobiography, it's a memoir. It's about how I remember things. You know, and some things you remember, and maybe they happened, maybe they didn't. My friend wrote a book about a very famous Californian punk singer, who I won't name, but he had some dreadlocks. Anyway, and he's kind of rhymed with, he told my friend a story, and my friend said, oh, it's a great story, you should put this in the book. And there were six other people who were involved in the story, and my friend went to all the other six people, and they all said the same thing. He wasn't there. He wasn't there when this happened. It's just we've told him the story so many years, and he's put himself in the story. So you have to be careful, you know. You know, like I wasn't there when he landed on the moon. You know, that didn't happen to me.
I couldn't write a memoir, I'd forget everything. I'm a terrible memory.
It's probably best to get lost in this action, too.
Porque decías, Alfonso, que te identificabas con algunas de estas historias, ¿no? Como la dinámica de una banda de rock siempre es compleja. Y creo yo, y ustedes me dirán porque nunca he estado en una, pero cerca de algunas, es que hay que saber negociar de una manera que a lo mejor ahora no es tan común que las bandas se queden juntas, es decir, nosotros hicimos esta banda y nos quedamos hasta la muerte, ¿no? Ahora, tú lo has visto también, bueno, estaba en esta banda, luego se fueron a la otra, luego se fueron a la otra, y es normal, pero creo que cuando nació la escena del rock en español en nuestro país, se quedaron ahí, por eso siguen existiendo los Caifanes, y La Maldita, y Café Tacuba, y un montón, en ese sentido, Alfonso, ¿crees que ha tenido como un trayecto de tener que picar piedra mucho más que lo que ahora se hace? Ya terminó. La pregunta.
Picar piedra.
Es decir, a lo que me refiero es a llevar su cassette a una estación de radio, a llevar su cassette a un lugar en donde querían tocar, que no había una facilidad como un clic, como Spotify.
Sí, bueno, tiempos, la industria era totalmente diferente, ¿no? Si no tenías una gran disquera atrás, bueno, o pequeña disquera, no puedes hacer nada, ¿no? Todo el mundo puede subir su música a través de las redes sociales sin necesidad de ningún intermediario, ¿no? Lo cual se presta para cosas buenas y cosas malas también. Hay una sobreexposición del material que muchas veces no tiene la calidad suficiente o el contenido suficiente, aunque todo suena bien, porque ya las máquinas son muy buenas y puedes grabar algo muy profesional con cualquier computadora o una laptop. En tu casa puedes lograr una grabación de mucha calidad, cosa que antes necesitabas el gran estudio y un gran presupuesto atrás. Han cambiado muchísimo las cosas, ¿no? Pero el talento sigue siendo el talento y eso es lo muy importante. Hay gente con mucho talento ahora en México, pero creo que la atención de los chavos está en otro lado. No están apoyando a las bandas que empiezan, ¿no? Las bandas están tocando en cada una de las distintas ciudades, en los semilleros, en los bares. La gente prefiere ir a ver a un DJ poniendo música que oír una banda en vivo que no conoce. Es como decir, es como ir al cine, yo siempre pongo esa analogía, es como ir al cine y decir, no quiero ir al cine porque no he visto la película, ¿no?
Claro.
La gente no quiere ir a ver bandas, a descubrir bandas, no quiere que seamos nosotros cuando estábamos chavos, ir a ser sus padres, a ir a las bandas, a encontrar a los nuevos Rolling Stones ahí, que entre las bandas que empiezan, que ocupan los lugares que tenemos nosotros hace tantos años, ya, las bandas, los festivales, los que se llaman, son siempre las mismas, ¿no?
Right, I think that's a very important point. You know, I had the same conversation with my son one day ago. My son plays in a band, and said to him, well, you know, when we started, you had to go to people, you had to make an effort to go to see them. That was the only way you could find out about music. Now, music's on your phone, it's everywhere, Spotify, everywhere, and that's it. You know, to me, it seems almost like the internet destroyed it. You know, it's not really possible, maybe sometimes, to know what the context is. You know, all the time you hear the songs, but you don't necessarily know what do they stand for, who are they, how do they go. So, you know, I hope that it can come to a better understanding. I think what we have to do, maybe as musicians, is add to our portfolio to be more like, you know, Renaissance people. That was actually one of the reasons I wanted to write the book, because I knew in my heart that by showing people something else as well, it would bring everything else up. And so, now I'm looking forward when I finish here, I'm going back to record with another good friend of mine and we'll make some new music, but it's like, now I have a basis for that, to work in the modern world.
Vamos a hacer una sesión de preguntas y respuestas. Les pido por favor que sean muy concretos en sus preguntas para que podamos aprovechar este tiempo. Pero, first of all, we need to talk about your jacket. Your jacket.
Oh, my jacket. Oh, yeah. So this is the jacket. I don't know if anybody saw that in March, The Cure were inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. And so I thought, well, if I'm going there, I have to get myself a beautiful jacket. I have to have a cloth tuxedo, because everybody wears something like that. So I asked a good friend of mine, and I realized when I was coming to Guadalajara, I should bring this jacket because it's made by a Mexican designer who's very famous, Adolfo Sanchez, and he's a good friend of mine. So I just wanted to celebrate his beautiful jacket. But it's my connection. That's right. And then the part of the that we need to be celebrated here in England.
Great. You know about this. Tenemos que eliminar. ¿Hay people? Okay, entonces preguntas. Ufale, hay muchísimas. Primero, el caballero de. Si tenemos micrófono, les pido a nuestros chicos que nos ayuden. Gracias, Maritza.
Hola, Alfonso, Enrique, amigos.
Hola.
Hola, Lorenzo, Lorenz. Very nice to hear you. When I was 18 years old, I went to England and we went to see a Cure concert. I'm a musician and a very big influence. I want to ask you about the song, which is one of my favorites, which is The Wailing Wall. The Wailing Wall from the top. You were playing keyboards or drums in that album, and I'm assuming that album was recorded because of the journeys that the Cure did that time in the Mediterranean. Is that so? El album, the top, the
right.
Cure.
Okay. Yes.
Tú grababas teclados.
Yes.
Y batería, supongo, ¿no?
Right. Keyboards.
Ese álbum para mí es muy experimental y sobre todo la canción The Wailing Wall. Todos los efectos de sonido eran muy innovadores para aquella época por el tipo de grababan en cintas. ¿Cómo te sentiste cuando grabaste The Top?
Well, it was very cold, I remember that. That's almost an impossible question. People say, well, how did you write this? How did you do that music? I mean, Alfonso knows this. It's, people say, well, how did this song come about? Well, it came about because of us being there. There's no point where one person goes, okay, here's the song we're going to play. I have it all of it written, everything done. It doesn't happen like that, it's like you sit there and talk with your friends and somebody will say, okay, I have this bit, I have this thing, okay, well, maybe I can put something like this on it, I can change this bit here. And so they're very organic. All Cure records are organic in that way. The thing with The Top was it was just myself and Robert for most of it, and Andy, we knew Andy, and Andy came along, did most of the drums because I was trying to do more stuff on the keyboards. And it was winter. Oh, and I broke one of Robert's really most precious guitars.
on a strike. And then I broke it a year later after that event. Yeah, Fox near drop, I dropped it on the ground. That's what I remember.
About a cat?
Hola. Bueno, yo soy un seguidor del club desde los 12 años y me gustaría preguntarte, LOL, si en un futuro cercano o muy pronto te unirías a la banda a seguir tocando junto con Robert y Simon. ¿Crees que eso pueda suceder en un futuro pronto?
You know, it's always difficult to talk about that because, on one hand, yes, that would be lovely, you know? On the other hand, we all have other stuff to do, and I don't want to make it so, you know, the thing with Reflections, it came about very naturally. I think if we just said, oh, okay, well, let's go out because it'll make, you know, a lot of money and it'll be, you know, good to do, I don't think it would be right. I think if there's ever a chance when we'll get together again, it will happen naturally and it won't be a full process. It'll just be like, hey, we should do that now. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank
you. Thank you.
Thank
Hola, hi Lauren, sorry. My question is more like, what pushed you to write this book?
Okay.
And also, I know that you have a lot of experience in, you know, world tours, and writing songs, and I understand the feeling of all that kind of things, all the path that you cross. What path can you say, or what feeling that you can tell us that it was to write this book?
Okay. I think for me to write a book was very similar to making a record. Just takes a lot longer, and you spend a lot longer talking about it. But there is one good thing about it. When you come and do tours, well, there's lots of good things, but one good thing is you do a tour. If you're a musician, you never get to bed before 2 a.m. minimum. Doesn't matter what show you do, you know, 2 a.m. or 4 a.m. But with this, you're probably finished in about half an hour, you know, you go home. So, but, you know, besides that, I don't know, for me it was a very similar process to write. I mean, obviously, you know, a book is a whole bigger story. A book was like writing an album. You know, back in the day, I know people just make one song now and put it out and stuff, but it, you know, we used to think very deeply about how to make an album, a whole journey, you know, from beginning to end. Especially when it's a record, you could split it over to make one side this way and another side something different. The book is the same thing. You know, the book I made it into 3 parts on purpose because. Well, the hardest part to write is the middle, because that's all the part about the cure. And that's the part that all cure fans think they know. So, yeah, I have to, like, you know, mess with some people's heads about what actually happened and what was real. And the first part was easy, because it was just me and Michael and Robert, so nobody could really disagree with me. I could write anything, and tell maybe, you know. And the last part is after the cure. You know, it's easy too, because, you know, it's near in my mind. I enjoyed the process very much.
You don't have to do sound check?
So, yeah, no sound checks. No sound checks. And, yeah, exactly. And you can go out for dinner afterwards. You're not looking for something at 2 in the morning.
Hi, I want to ask that Curious is a really good book right now. They're now in Dylan Legacy. And the Curious are in a very good moment right now. They are doing Legacy, as you said, the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, and they're recently celebrating 4 years of career. do you still miss playing that band? As a Cure, do you still miss playing with your childhood friends?
As well as answer that question.
Do you still miss playing with your childhood friends?
Yeah. Yeah, I miss my friends. I'm playing with them. I play with them all from time to time a bit. You know, I play with Michael, I play with Robert, I play with Simon, I play with Pearl and stuff. I miss the camaraderie. That's what I miss, you know, because that's the human part of it all. It's like I was telling you, when we get together, we don't talk about music, we don't talk about business, we talk about, you know, family. That's what it is to me, it's my family. You know?
Buenas noches al panel. Aquí una excelente baterista, una banda legendaria como The Cure. Inteligentemente en introducción Mariana comentaba de las bandas hispanas. Tenemos a André que de Caifanes y de La Barranca. Excelentes bandas mexicanas. Café Tacuba, se mencionó Soda Stereo, ya de Argentina. Yo, hay una intriga, la meca del rock mundial es en la Gran Bretaña, eso no tenemos duda. Inclusive más arriba que Estados Unidos. Y ahí se mueve el rock, cualquier bifurcación como tal. Mi intriga es preguntarte de una banda legendaria como The Cure, ¿alguna banda hispana que te haya movido, que hayas escuchado en algún momento de tu carrera como músico, ya sea española, argentina, mexicana? Bien.
And I'm not just saying that because he's sitting next to me, but, you know. We talked about it beforehand, all drummers are friends, you know? So you have to remember that, all drummers are friends. The guitarists, not so much, you know? They don't like telling each other their secrets, you know? They're like, how did you do that? And they're like, no, they won't tell you. But drummers are friends.
I'm very familiar with the band because ever since I can recall, my father has been a big fan of yours. So I have two questions for you. Number one is, just as The Cure has inspired many bands nowadays, what was an inspiration that you guys had to create The Cure? That's number one. And number two, I couldn't make it to your book sign. That would mean the whole world to me if you could sign the book for my dad as presents.
We are here.
Oh, okay. Yes, of course I'll sign the book.
My first question.
And what's the inspiration for the band?
Yeah,
or?
What inspired by Spring?
Why? I think that's it. You know, I mean, I always created from what happened to me. You know, I think that's the only way you can do it. Otherwise, it's like the some strange other person doing things, you know. It's hard to explain that one.
Okay, thank you. Hola, Leo. La pregunta la voy a hacer en español porque mi inglés es muy malo. ¿A qué le atribuyes?
As far as Spanish is.
¿A qué atribuyes que una banda como The Cure siga vigente al día de hoy? Que su música sea tan trascendente, generación tras generación, y que bandas que se formaron hace 5 o 2 años ya no tengan ningún tipo de trascendencia. ¿A qué le atribuyes tú la trascendencia musical? Y todo el camino que trazó The Cure, que influyó a tantas y a tantas generaciones de músicos. Y si también puedes firmar mi libro.
Okay, sure. And then, sure. Right,
I love you.
The The question is twofold. We didn't grow up in the center of the city. We were outside, so we were allowed to grow without having to be fashionable. You know, we didn't have any pressure to be fashionable. We just sort of did what we thought we should do. And also, I think what the Cure speaks to, lyrically and musically to a certain extent, is relevant to all human beings. It's, you know, we wrote a lot about that period where you go from being teenage and into adults, and all of that alienation and feeling of being outside that comes from that, questioning a lot of stuff. And that's universal. So that's intergenerational. You're right. I mean, I do these kind of events. I've done 300 in the last 3 years, I think. And I've seen people from 60 years old to 16. The people that are 16 weren't even alive when I left the band. You know, it blows my mind. But I'm humbled and flattered by knowing that we managed to make that change, you know, which is amazing to me.
Tenemos tiempo para dos preguntas más, una aquí y otra acá en el final. Dos preguntas más y después ya firmas. Y para por lo menos dos personas tienen una exclusiva. Adelante.
Hello, Lon. It's an honor that we are here, that you're visiting us, and for me to be here asking you. Which would be your favorite album, your favorite song, and your favorite B-side, and why?
Well, I can answer that very easily. I have no favorites. It's like having favorite children. You can't have favorite children, you know. I like Joe, but I don't really like David, you know. It's, it changes from week to week. You know, sometimes I listen to Faith and I like that, and sometimes I listen to Pornography. I like Pornography because I like the drums on it, you know.
Cuando leas Cure, existe un buen episodio hablando de Pornography y de lo que significa para LOL. Pornography, cómo se hizo, como lo más básico que tiene. Sí, es bien interesante esa parte de Cure. Una más por allá, ¿dónde estaba?
Thank you, Lon.
Perdón, ya hicimos correr a nuestra compañera.
Hola, buenas noches. Alfonso, quería preguntar algo, una duda que tengo desde hace muchos años. Cuando la Cure iba a tocar por primera vez en México, en Monterrey, bueno, muchos especulábamos que la Barbie Calhoun era una petición, un deseo bastante fuerte. Creo que estaban ahí en el internet, que iban a sacar el silencio o algo así. Y bueno, finalmente no abrieron el concierto.
Yo estaba ahí en público.
¿Ha habido en alguna ocasión alguna posibilidad de que puedan abrirle o compartir el escenario, o un deseo de que puedan compartir en algún momento el escenario con The Cure?
Yeah, we share the stage now. Thank you.